Thank you so much, Maddie, and thank you everybody for joining us. This is an example of digital adaptation right here as we all contend with this brave new world that we have entered. And actually, I'd like everybody to just, one of the reasons we really wanted to host this is to start having community again, because I feel like one of the big casualties of the last week is people feeling like they're very fractured and alone and isolated as we all try to deal with the ever-evolving situation. Doug and Maddie felt it was really important, even though Stephen Carpenter couldn't speak today, to still keep the series going. And I was delighted to be asked to fill in. But in the spirit of community and in the spirit of all of us coming together, I'd like to invite you to close your eyes for a second and then just take a breath. It doesn't have to be a deep breath. It's just a normal breath. And let it out. And another breath in. And another breath out. Because I think we've all been running around like crazy, trying to adapt, trying to figure out what this changing world looks like for us, just in the time of coronavirus, let alone all the other things we've been talking about in this series of showcases about the time is now. And it's important to take stock and to join together in community for a while and just sit and be still and think and ponder. And I'm grateful to be able to join you all today for this chance to ponder adaptation in a changing world. So I'm gonna go ahead and now share my slides. So let's see if I can make this work. Hopefully everybody sees the slides up on the screen now. By the way, along the way, if you have questions throughout, if you go to the bottom of your screen and highlight over, you will see different options, one of which is chat. It may look like a little like text, like speech bubble with three dots in it, and that gets you to the chat box. And at any time during this talk, please feel free to put in questions you have for me. Maddie, you'll be monitoring the chat box throughout, and then at the end of the talk, we can kind of go through any of the questions that emerge along the way. So I wanted to start with just this image, just because it's a nice peaceful image and I like it. It's also an image, it's a sculpture called The Angel, made by a sculptor, Jason Decares Taylor. And he is a sculptor who works down in Mexico and is very concerned about coral reefs and the disappearance of the coral reefs, and wanted to think about what could he do about it with the power of his artistic storytelling. And the solution he came up with was the idea of paying and hiring local Mexican residents in communities along the coastline to be his sculptural models. And he would take casts of them and then create sculptures of different types that are a reflection of humankind and human nature. And then he put them out into the ocean as artificial reefs. And his purpose for doing this was threefold. One, he really wanted to create stories that tell commentary about changes in nature and how humans are affecting that. Two, he wanted to create artificial reefs to create additional habitat for underwater species to recover. And then three, he thought by creating an underwater sculpture garden, and there are now several dozen sculptures in artificial reefs off the coast of Mexico, that they could be an attraction for cruise ships and dive ships who wanted to come see underwater attractions and maybe pull them away from natural reefs in the hopes that it would take pressure off the natural reefs. And so I think it's a beautiful example of the power of art to provide what I'm gonna talk about towards the end of this call, webinar, called active hope. The idea that you not only are hopeful for the future, but that you take action around it and that your vision of the future is expressed in the stories and the actions that you take. And I think it's a good segue into our talk today, in which I'm gonna be kind of ranging back and forth, both into the natural world and into our present day situation, since it's been on my mind, and I have a feeling it's on the minds of everybody on this call. So I'm gonna start with a short film. This is a 2-minute film called Papyroflexia. It's by filmmaker Joaquin Baldwin, and see what you all think. Can everybody hear it?
Perfect.
And so I think this is a film, it's very popular. It made a festival circuit all around the world and was brought in many times. And a lot of people talked about this film as being this beautiful film of hope. And I was thinking about this film a lot this week and wondering whether or not it's a hopeful story actually, because it reminded me a lot. Some of you may have seen this story this week, people looking for any kind of news that's not immediately about the coronavirus. And we're pointing out that in Venice, because all the boat traffic has been halted by people sheltering in place, that the canals have become clear enough that people can see to the bottom again and see fish, and that swans and dolphins have appeared in the canals for the first time in years. And lots of people were talking about this as, oh, this is this beautiful story of hope. And I do think it's beautiful and wonderful that we see nature and people reaching out for that nature. But I do wonder whether or not it's a hopeful story, because so many of the articles I saw about this and so many of the comments about the film Papyroflexia that we just watched talk about this idea that it's hopeful because humans haven't screwed up the world so badly that when we disappear, nature will not disappear as well. That people are excited that the idea that nature is resilient beyond humanity and will outlast us. And that's a misanthropic kind of mentality, I would argue, because in some ways, if your vision of the future that's hopeful is, it's okay, nature will keep going when we disappear, then your vision of future is one where we're not here, and that's the hope. And that's not a particularly hopeful vision for the future. I was also thinking about this, if you've not read this book, I would highly recommend it. It's by a professor at University of Arizona, Alan Weissman, called The World Without Us, in which he imagines what would the world look like if humanity just instantly vanished, what would stay, what would disappear, both in terms of our material culture and in terms of natural species, and went all over the world to explore this question. And again, people talked about his book as being this hopeful one, because as he says, nature has been through worse losses before and refilled empty niches. And even today, there are still a few earthly spots where all our senses can inhale a living memory of this Eden before we were here. Inevitably, they invite us to wonder how nature might flourish if granted the chance. And a lot of people, again, were saying, see, his book proves, you know, we just have to get rid of humanity, or don't worry, humanity is not screwing things up so badly. And that's the hopeful vision. And I would say, so where do people and where does human civilization fit into this story? Why are we trying to write ourselves out of our vision of the future? And I pose this question to you to think about, and we'll come back to it at the end of the talk today. But I'll tell you that how I got to this question myself was my own research and just personal interest in life started with the world without wildlife. I'm somebody who has been fascinated by animals since I was a little kid and worried about wildlife growing up, as I'm sure many of you are as well. As we know, we're losing species at an unprecedented rate of extinction, now up to 27 species per day, when the background rate of extinction historically has been one species every 10,000 years. And I, as a kid, was, you know, fascinated by penguins and elephants and Amazonian tree frogs and worried about what would a world look like without wildlife, and how do we protect wildlife? How do we keep them in our vision and our stories of the future? And as I thought about that question, and you know, I think it's one that many people share, one of the things that interests me about my own personal story in thinking about that is that it doesn't come from a direct experience with wildlife. I'm a suburban kid from New Jersey and North Carolina. You know, I saw squirrels, I saw blue jays and robins and cardinals, and on the occasional family trip got to see bison in Yellowstone. But by and large, the animals that I was interested in, the penguins and the elephants and the chimpanzees, I don't know personally. I don't have a connection to them by having seen them in the wild. And we live at a point now in human history where most of our connections to animals and to nature generally doesn't come from direct personal experience. It comes from our experience through media. And whether that's National Geographic magazines or television specials, you know, featuring Jane Goodall and her amazing research in Gombe with the chimpanzees in Tanzania, or whether it's memes on Snapchat and Instagram and Facebook, we know nature now more and more through the stories that we tell about it, rather than through direct personal experience. And yet those stories are so powerful that they do make us care about whether or not nature exists out in the wild and beyond the digital and media worlds that we are now very much living in, thanks to coronavirus. And the interesting thing is, we've been interested as a species in other species for our whole existence. The earliest known art on the planet, the cave paintings in Chavre, France, 19,000 years old. What are they pictures of? They're pictures of animals. They're pictures of the species that were either totems or hunted or some other form of fascination for the earliest human civilizations. And similarly, we can credit all of our modern digital world, all of our films and our television, everything photographic, a lot of it comes from our fascination with animals. Leland Stanford, the gentleman for whom Stanford University is named and former governor of California, had a bet with a friend because he was interested in animals and horses in particular, and wondered, when a horse is galloping, are all 4 feet ever off the ground at the same time? That's not a question you can easily answer just with looking with the naked eye. And so he hired this gentleman in the photo here, Edward Muybridge, who is a renowned photographer, to help him figure out the answer. And what Muybridge did was he set up a series of cameras along a horse track and had tripwires across the track set up to the camera shutter so that as the horse broke the tripwire, each camera would take a picture. And the result is this. This from 1877 is arguably the first motion picture ever created. And it is created because we are fascinated by other animals and their movements. And if I stop this at just the right time, we can in fact see that yes, a horse's four legs are all off the ground at the same time. So we owe motion pictures and all the kind of digital media that follows from a start of fascination with animals and with other species. And that's continued out throughout the whole history of modern media. If we were in a room and I was looking out at an audience, I would ask you guys all to raise your hands. How many people have seen Walt Disney's Bambi? And I'm guessing that most of you are raising your hands if you're choosing to go along with this. It's certainly one of the most ubiquitous stories in our current culture. I see some people have raised their hands, in fact. Bambi, as you probably know, is a Walt Disney film. It was the second film, feature-length animated film that Walt Disney ever made. It's the fifth one that came out because there was so much challenge in terms of the making of the film and Disney's quest to make it as naturalistic as possible. We'll actually watch just a little teeny tiny clip here from the April shower scene, just to show the great animation.
Sky is cloudy, your pretty musical bride. is calling, you come along with us all right away. Come with the beautiful music, then drop a little April shower, be a tune as you fall.
And I'm going to stop it there. Only just to say that it shows Disney's craft at telling stories with animals that combine music, that combine imagery, that combine sounds, that combine making animals very recognizably animal, but also a little bit slightly human in their anthropomorphism to create these masterful stories that people respond to, largely about animals. And Bambi has been incredibly influential as a film. Almost instantaneously, it changed the American public's sense of deer, not on film, but in the wild. Just a few years later in 1944, for example, Wisconsin was dealing with an overpopulation of deer and wanted to have a hunt for does. And when the public heard this, the outcries that people would be killing Bambi's mother was so great that the state legislature had to back down and not do a doe hunt. And even up into the 1990s, in California, there was a ballot initiative about whether or not to have mountain lion hunting or to ban mountain lion hunting. And the San Francisco Chronicle did a survey of the public, and they found that if you said hypothetically that a mountain lion had killed a human child, or hypothetically that a mountain lion had killed a baby fawn, people were more likely to support hunting mountain lions if they heard that mountain lions had killed a baby fawn than if they had heard that a mountain lion had killed a human child. This is what some hunting and other natural critics have called the Bambi syndrome, that people have gotten so in love with Bambi and so fearful of humankind's impact on Bambi ever since the film's great line that everybody remembers, when Bambi's mom says, "Man is in the forest," and then a few scenes later is shot by the hunters, that people have forever changed how they relate to deer in the wild because of the stories we tell about deer in our media. And so if you're thinking about how do I deal with wildlife conservation, and if you're thinking about nature and your how to protect it, we have a lot of great people working in the sciences here at Penn State, a lot of great biologists, who are thinking very hard about things like habitat loss and fragmentation and climate change and invasive species. But you also really need to think about how am I telling stories about the things that I'm trying to protect, because that will shape how people think about the work that I'm trying to do. And there have been people who are starting to be very savvy to this. The woman you see in the picture here is Cynthia Moss, who's one of the most preeminent elephant researchers in the world, has been working for over 50 years in Amboseli National Park in Kenya. And Amboseli is actually one of the smallest parks in Kenya, but it has one of the most robust elephant populations. And that's because largely of her work, both studying and trying to protect the elephants and trying to build a sustainable community and economy for the communities living around the park. And very early on, Dr. Moss realized that if she wanted her work to be successful, she had to engage with media. And so she reached out and worked with BBC and PBS to create a documentary about elephants. And she knew she needed to have an elephant star. And the interesting thing is, if you read her autobiography, which is there, Elephant Memories, on the screen, it's over 300 pages, and she tells amazing, wonderful stories of her personal connections to all sorts of elephants that she's known and watched be born and die and all the family relationships. And the elephant that she chose for her television stardom for creating this film is an elephant matriarch, Echo. And the interesting thing is Echo actually only appears in one page of Dr. Moss's autobiography. And nowhere near as often as any of the other elephants that she clearly has much more of a personal bond to. And if you look at that one page, the one thing she describes Echo is, she says, quote, "Echo is a real homebody." And in interviewing her, I found that she said, yeah, that was her consideration, that she knew that if she was gonna tell stories about elephants on film, she needed an elephant that she could always find, that she could always bring filmmakers to and get good video of. And since Echo and her family rarely moved out of the same part of the park, she always knew she could take filmmakers there. So that's the reason she made Echo into a star. That was the consideration she was trying to think. That, and also if you notice in the picture of Echo, her tusks are slightly cross-eyed and tilted towards each other as opposed to parallel like most elephant tusks. So it makes her more recognizable in the midst of a herd and therefore easier to tell a story with visually. And it worked. The documentary was so successful that there were two successive documentaries. When Echo died naturally of old age at 65 in 2009, there were weeping odes and praises to her from all over the world. People actually came to the park and found her bones and would leave notes inside the bones about how much she had personally meant to them. This elephant that they had never actually met before, but only had met through the stories that Cynthia Moss was telling about them. So she has been very savvy about thinking about how do we protect animals in the real world by changing and adapting how we tell stories about them online and in our media world. And she's also realized that that needs to keep evolving and adapting because our media is continually evolving and adapting, as we all know right now, as we're evolving and adapting this week. So she has worked on creating websites where people can adopt an elephant family and then log in to see the latest updates and gossip about that family and videos. She's worked in social media and realized that in social media, when you tell stories, if you tell a lot of negative stories, people don't like them and they don't click them. So on Instagram and Facebook, she's got to tell three happy stories for every one concerning story to make sure that people will still stay engaged. She's also realized that you need to reach out to different audiences, that Western audiences have become much more aware of the threat of ivory hunting, whereas the ivory hunt is largely driven now by Chinese audiences, who aren't necessarily evil or bad, it's just a lot of them don't know about the dangers of ivory. A survey found that 33% of the Chinese public knew that ivory came from elephants being slaughtered. The rest mostly thought that elephants naturally lost their tusks every year in much the same way that deer lose their antlers. So she and other people have worked on campaigns like with Yao Ming, the former Houston Rockets NBA superstar, who's one of the biggest celebrities in China, invited him out to create a whole series of video elephant diaries. They've hired Chinese language communications people on their Amboseli Trust for Elephants communication staff to make sure that they are putting their social media in the right places, not just a Chinese language film on YouTube, where most Chinese residents don't go, but onto Youku or iQIYI or some of the other big platforms in China where you're likely to actually hit the right audiences. So it really has become this constant process of trying to digitally adapt her elephants to our changing media world. And she's doing it because this idea of digital adaptation is important. We protect the things that we care about, and we care about the things that we see. So which animals are we actually seeing? And if you care about conservation, if you're somebody who's working in conservation biology, you have to think about what you are telling stories about and how you tell stories and how you adapt the thing that you're telling a story about to the particular media. Because some animals like elephants, it's very easy to tell great stories either on Facebook or in YouTube or in documentaries. Other animals, maybe not so much. So for example, the fish there in the top right corner, which is being shown to scale with a paperclip, is a snail darter, which is infamous in some circles for being the first major challenge to the US Endangered Species Act, when after the act was passed, they were building the Tellico Dam in Tennessee, and people discovered that this threatened species of fish was going to be potentially impacted in its habitat and blocked the dam construction. And a lot of people were like, you're going to stop construction of a dam because of a fish the size of a paperclip? And the problem is, if you haven't told stories about these animals, if we don't feel a connection to them, it's hard to argue back against that beyond just the kind of broad biodiversity is important, protect all species, which a lot of scientists may very much believe, but it's a lot harder to kind of convey to the general public. Or take, for example, the poor species there in the middle there, that is the Cumberland mussel. Which is a pearly mussel. And it has the unfortunate distinction of being the least funded of any species that is listed under the US Endangered Species Act. For the most recent year that I could find information, the US government spent a whopping total of $60 to try to protect that species for the year. And so obviously, if you're a researcher or somebody cares about this mussel, you got to figure out, how do I adapt this species to the online and media environment where I can get people to care about it? What are the stories that I can tell? because it's hard to get people to care about a Cumberland bun. It's a lot easier to get them to care about something like this. That's very memeable. You can, you know, put it in Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Snapchat. You can tell funny stories about it. You can adapt it for all sorts of storytelling needs. And that's why people tend to focus in on protecting penguins, like the emperor penguin, much more than they do like species like the snail darter. And so for me, in my research, this has really been the question: how do we tell different stories? How do we adapt species to tell stories that aren't easily adapted to the changing digital landscape that we find ourselves in? Because if we really are serious about wildlife conservation, we can't just focus on the threats to species in nature, like habitat loss and climate change. We have to focus on the threat to their not being part of our cultural conversation. And so this actually then brings me back to thinking about people and where we started our call today. Because in thinking about a future for people, we also want to think about, well, what's the hopeful vision for people? It's not just a question of who we're telling stories about, or even what's the format, as you know, Cynthia Moss and others are concerned about with wildlife. It's really a question of what are the stories that we're telling about the future? Because beyond things like papyroflexia that we watched earlier, if you really take a look around and look at the stories that we're telling, this is the story that we're telling over and over again.
My world is fire and blood.
Everything is dependent on oil.
We are killing for gasoline.
The world is almost out of water.
Water. Now there's the water wars.
Here they come again.
Everybody's gone out of their mind.
A nice, cheery, happy vision of the future from Mad Max Fury Road, which won 5 Oscars and grossed over $300 million around the world, proving that people are watching these stories. And, you know, if you look at the kind of long list of stories that we have going on from the last 20 years, it's all stories like this. It's The Day After Tomorrow, Children of Men, even WALL-E, which I just skipped over a clip of in the interest of time. Their best vision of a future for humans is one in which we've trashed the planet so badly that we've left it behind as a garbage dump, and we are now impotent babies in space floating along staring at our cell phone screens. And that's the best vision that we seem to have for where humanity is headed. And this is a depressing kind of litany of stories to constantly tell. They are all about apocalypse. And if they're not about apocalypse, the future that has hope in a lot of our stories these days is ones that are about superheroes. We're helpless, we can't fix things, we can't solve things, our government is impotent, we are, you know, incapable of doing things, but let's have the Avengers or Wonder Woman or some other hero come in and save things for us. And that's not a very hopeful message either. And I think a lot about this because, you know, even the preeminent, most hopeful vision of the future from the last few decades in popular culture, Star Trek, where originally Gene Roddenberry's vision of the future is one in which we've overcome racism, we've overcome hunger, we've overcome nationalism, has turned progressively darker and darker in each new iteration. And there's a quote from Star Trek that I often think about, which is, when a man is convinced he's going to die tomorrow, he'll probably find a way to make it happen. And I think it's really important to think through that quote and think about it. The philosopher Martin Heidegger has this idea called inframing, in which he says, we make true the things that we repeat over and over, the ideas that we put out into the world, the simple act of repetition makes them so. And if we keep repeating over and over these apocalyptic stories, we are not going to adapt very well to this changing future. Instead, we need to be looking for new, different stories. We need to be looking for stories like the one we started with Jason DeCaris Taylor's sculpture of active hope, where people are rolling up their sleeves and figuring out what they want that future to look like and how the hard work gets done to make that happen. And we have plenty of people rolling up their sleeves and doing that hard work now. But if we're not putting those stories out there in such a way that they inspire different visions of the future, then people are going to constantly think that the future is apocalyptic. They're going to think that the future is one in which the big problems that we have been talking about throughout this whole showcase series are ones that are not solvable. And so my challenge to people is to think about, can we envision different stories? Even Alan Weisman, who wrote The World Without Us, said, since we're imagining, why not also dream of a way for nature to prosper that doesn't depend on our demise? Is it possible that instead of heaving a huge biological sigh of relief, the world without us would miss us? So how do we start to tell those stories of active hope? And I'm going to leave you with one final short film. It's a film made by a former student of mine, Kat Cameron. She made this for a film festival that I did at the University of Wisconsin. And they were charged with making short films about visions of the future. Now, just to warn you, they used found footage so that they didn't have to learn a lot of camera work. But they're still trying to collate that found footage into a vision. And this is her vision of the future. It's called Uproot.
My father reminisced often. He missed the old days. The days when our food came from far away. Meat from Brazil, avocados from Chile, oranges from Florida. The days of overconsumption. Then the government sent us notices, saying that how we lived was harming our communities and the world outside us. They told us we should abandon our old ways. It was time to start anew, to grow our own food for once. The older generations in my community, including my father, went begrudgingly. But for being forced to give up our old lives, we went willingly, peacefully, planted the seeds of assimilation, kale, and carrots. During the first few months, everything felt senseless, covered in earth. But meaning eventually came. Through the silence, early mornings in the garden, biking in the rain, I grew a lot in these calm moments. My father still complained, but his cough was disappearing. He liked the feeling of the sun on his face and seeing a blue sky. What had seemed like unnecessary chores and silly responsibilities, the life I had dreaded and avoided, made me feel more alive. I appreciated the trouble everyone had gone through to sustain our world. It wasn't trouble. It was living.
So I would challenge you as a closing thought, where are those stories? Where are more stories like this? And how can we put them out into the world? Because as we are all trying to adapt digitally and otherwise to a very uncertain and changing world, the stories we tell are the ones that give us hope. They're the ones that give us vision. And they're the ones that help us figure out what we want that future to look like, whether it's a future with elephants or a future in which all the issues of sustainability that we've been talking about throughout this series are ones that we address. So put those stories out there and think about how we can build stories of active hope together. So thank you, and feel free to submit questions in the chat box.
Nice. Yes, thank you so much, Peter. If anyone does have questions, feel free to put them in the chat. Also, we might try out like raising your hand, that function, and actually using audio depending. We have our first question. So Peter, kicking it off to you, they said, great talk. Agree we need good stories, stories of hope. So how can we tell stories about something we cannot see, like viruses? How can we create stories fast enough to have real-time impact?
Ooh, coronavirus, that's a big challenge. But again, I think a lot of it comes from moving forward and then looking backwards. There's work by researchers, and I'm sorry, I only know his first name, Yoshi, in Japan, who has discovered that if you put yourself in the position of, I am 50 years from now, or even let's say with coronavirus, I am 2 years from now, and I am looking backwards on the past, and I am at the point where the thing that I wanted to see has happened. Now let me tell you the story from 50 years in the future or 2 years in the future of how I got to this desired future. It's easier to figure out and imagine and actually work towards than if you say, I am here in the present looking 2 years into the future and I want that to be my future. That they've done studies that found that just by doing that mental exercise before sitting down to tackle city government issues, that city governments were actually more willing to plan for the long term, that people were more willing to see the yeses and the possibilities as opposed to the noes. So I don't know how fast we get out some of those stories for something like coronavirus, but just in general, putting yourself in the future and saying, this is it, we got here, and then looking back is going to be much more productive than saying, I'm feeling helpless in the present, and I hope that we get to that thing. I'm optimistic, or I'm crossing my fingers that we get to that present without, or that future without thinking about it.
Awesome, thank you. So there's a few questions in the chat about a recording link, and that will definitely be sent out. I will post that on Facebook as well as our website, as well as probably in the follow-up email, like the weekly update. So you will get that and be able to send it out to students or anyone that you might know.
And both of those films are available online, and I can give those links to Maddie if you want links to either the Papyroflexia or the Uproot. So,
are there any other questions? Also, if anyone is brave enough to try out the like raise the hand function and ask a question via audio, feel free to do that. Okay, here's another question. So why do you think we're so doom and gloom about our future?
There is this sense in which it shirks responsibility. If I just, you know, look ahead and project out from where I am and see all the problems and I don't want to solve them, it's just a lot easier to tell a story that says, yep, it all went to hell in a handbasket. It takes work to solve problems and it takes hard work to envision that. And I think people are reluctant to, you know, tell those stories for fear of being laughed at. It's not that they're reluctant to do the work, but they're reluctant to kind of put themselves out there and be shot down or have everybody else pile on the criticism. Academics are very good at doing that. With this is the not, no, this is the thing you haven't thought of. This is the thing that's going to be the problem. It's very easy to tear down. It's very hard to build up. And so I think it takes great courage to put out stories of active hope and to put out ideas and visions for the future for fear that people aren't going to accept them or are going to see them as too utopian. I think the other thing that we do struggle with is all of these stories are competing in a space in which it's about spectacle and it's about drama. That's what draws eyeballs. So it's great if you have the spectacle of a dolphin in the canals in Venice, that's like, ooh, a dolphin in Venice, that's cool. But it's, you know, the spectacle of things blowing up, the spectacle of alien invasions, those are, you know, what sell in movies. And sometimes the story that's a hopeful vision that includes lots of kind of difficult back and forth, slow progress is not a story that's particularly dramatic to tell. And so that is actually one of the challenges is how do we make those stories compelling enough while still being accurate for the vision that we want.
Awesome. Paul, did you have a question still?
But
I just unmuted you, so you should be good to go now.
Yeah, I don't know if you can.
Yeah.
Can you see me?
Yeah.
Yeah. I can't see myself. My technology is all screwed up. But I just wanted to show you a picture of my puppy that I'm walking with, and you are reminding us of important relationship to animals. So I just wanted to put him on record that she attended the webinar. Thank you, Peter. That was really great. Very profound talk. And clearly it raises many questions about what we should be doing and thinking in this difficult time. Really happy that you've taken this opportunity to keep the continuity in our community. So just want to say thanks.
Thanks, Paul.
Awesome. Thanks, Paul. So our next question is, do you know of anyone making a more hopeful film or TV show, or are you working on something yourself?
Ooh, throw down the gauntlet. That's a good challenge. I'm not working on something myself. I probably should be. I'm always looking for more hopeful stories in this vein. I haven't come across any of late. So if you have ideas, please feel free to email me or put them in the chat for other people to see. I've been talking with a colleague of mine who works at Lafayette University, who's an expert in the new emerging field of cli-fi, climate fiction, which is basically science fiction, but with or futuristic fiction with climate being at its focus. And a lot of those are really in the doom and gloom venue as well. There's one that may be too terrifying for some people right now. It's still fairly terrifying. It's called The Parable of the Sower by Octavia Butler. And basically it's also a pretty stark vision of the future, but within that, and it actually goes on to be a series of books, it is about a protagonist, a young woman, who is trying to create a new religion that emerges out of the chaos that is sowed by climate change. And it's a vision built around reconnecting with planting, reconnecting with understanding our connections to a community, to each other, to the soil. And it doesn't erase all the potential horrors that could happen from climate change, but it says, rather than try to fight against that, can we envision a new kind of hopeful theology coming out of that, and one of self-reliance and one of community. So it's still a pretty hard book to read and frightening, especially in the current times that we're in. But there is this vein of let's build a new kind of theology within it that I don't see a lot in a lot of other visions of the future. So that would be one that I'd recommend to people.
Awesome, thank you. Another question that we have is, how can we use these tools to help our staff, students, and communities as we are transitioning so quickly to an online environment?
I mean, I think one of the things is, let's take the opportunity to tell stories. Students today are incredibly good at creating narratives online, creating pastiches and mashups of videos and video clips from all over media. People are very media savvy. So it's an opportunity to engage people with, you're sitting at home, you're got a lot of time on the computer, maybe spend that time going out and finding the raw materials that you could put together, kind of like Kat did in terms of her found footage film there, Uproot, to tell different stories and to envision what those stories could look like. And I think that, especially going into Earth Day this coming month, which is the 50th anniversary of Earth Day, and is a real opportunity to look back at the last 50 years and all that we've accomplished, which we should note is significant. If you look back where we were in 1970 versus where we are now in terms of things like the Clean Air Act, the Clean Water Act, the Endangered Species Act, and all the ways in which we've addressed environmental justice as being an important part of our questions of sustainability, we've made significant progress and we should celebrate that progress. But it's also an ideal opportunity while we're all sitting at home kind of thinking about the future to let's look forward 50 years. What would Earth Day 2070 look like? What do we want it to look like? And let's jump forward to 2070 and say, we're in the future that we wanted. And let's look back and start telling the stories about how we got there.
Awesome. So Erin has a question. I'm gonna go ahead and unmute her. You're unmuted. Oh.
Yep. Hi, everybody. I just wanted to let you know, as part of the reflection project that came out of the Center for Performing Arts, I don't know if you guys are familiar with that, but they had a grant application to people could put in to develop a new course. And I did submit an application for storytelling and climate change with Natasha Sood, a third year medical student at Hershey. We were supposed to hear about it this week if we were going to get that grant, but due to all the craziness, we will be hopefully hearing next week. And if we get it, the interdomain course will be related to students finding stories about climate change, and then and also creating stories about climate change as part of the coursework. So I'm really excited about that.
Wow, that would be awesome. Fantastic.
Yeah, so and I already talked to Peter Buck, and he said if we don't get it through the Reflection Project, maybe talk to the Sustainability Institute about trying to develop the course without the funding from the grant. So we might be talking. Hopefully we don't have to because we got the grant, but if not, we may be in touch. So
fingers crossed.
Awesome. Thanks for sharing, Erin. So Roger has a question that kind of refers back to what you were talking about a little bit ago. So what are some good platforms to share stories like that?
That is a good question. There are story mapping softwares out there. There are some other things. I, off the top of my head, I'm gonna have to stop and think about that. So when Maddie sends out the recording and the link, I will send to her some ideas for platforms that can be included to answer that. That's a very good question.
That'd be great, thanks Peter. Does anyone else have a question? Or if they wanna raise their hand and make a comment via audio?
Well, if not, thank you all so much for joining us. And thank you, Maddie, for giving me this opportunity to pinch hit for Stephen Carpenter.
Yes, of course. Thank you, Peter. And thank you all for bearing with us as we test out these new online kind of materials. I am going to go send out the survey right now. So if you do have a chance, no matter if you loved having it online, hated it, we want to hear from you and just see how we can make this better. So I just sent out the Google form. If someone could just try clicking it and telling me if the link is good to go, that would be wonderful.
All right.
Okay, perfect. Well, thank you all so much for coming. We will be back here next Friday at noon with Tara Daniel. She is awesome. She works for a nonprofit organization called We Do. So they work with women and involving them in the environmental movement. So it should be really cool. She'll be joining us via Zoom, and I can send out more information throughout Facebook, throughout our weekly newsletters and whatnot. So thank you all. And if anyone wants to ask Peter additional questions, he can stay in the Zoom chat for a little longer, and feel free to unmute yourself or show your video and engage in a conversation with him or others. Thank you, though. Enjoy your day.